My name is Howard Rodman. I'm an associate professor at Idaho State University. I teach sports leadership. And I've done this for 8 years. Prior to this position, I was a college athletic director and head men's basketball coach for 25 years. And so when I had an opportunity to go into the classroom and teach, I jumped at it. I had been the athletic director at Idaho State. So the people in the sports science department knew me and kind of targeted me for the position. I'm the first full-time faculty member in sports science on the Meridian campus. So my boss is over in Pocatello. I've got a pretty good gig. It's nice. As a faculty member, we have to research and publish, and one of the areas that I stumbled upon as a researcher is positive leadership. And I read this concept, and I'm going, wow, that's me. That's who I want to be, at least. And so I've published a couple of articles and put together a model on what positive leadership is. And so I want to share some of these concepts with you. As you can tell, I'm passionate about positivity. Positivity has been shown to impact people's lives in a very positive way. I'm passionate about the power of positivity. I'm passionate about the power of positive leadership. With positive people, we live happier and healthier lives. The research shows that by being optimistic in nature, we reduce stress in our lives. We reduce chronic disease. We increase our immune system. And we live longer. How about that? That's research that has come out about being positive in nature. Positive leaders, on the other hand, their focus is to make people better. And that's what I'm focused on, trying to make people better. Because when you are a positive leader, people enjoy coming to work in the morning. They work harder. They're more productive. They work longer. Have you ever had a bad boss? It's not fun. As an athletic director at one of the schools, not Idaho State, but one of the schools, I had a boss that was so controlling and so negative that she fired and rehired every direct report except me and another person. It was just miserable. People would come to work or look for ways to call in sick. So when I came in and saw this concept, I'm going, huh, there you go. People are happy. People are healthy. People want to be there. They're going to work hard. As players on the team, they're going to practice hard. The workers aren't looking forward to clocking out and going home. The players aren't looking at the clock wondering when practice is going to end. They want to be there. They want to get better. Positive leadership. We can look at two different coaches and their styles. Kind of polar opposite. The first one is Mike Rice, former basketball coach at Rutgers University. I don't know if you saw him in the headlines a year ago. Let's watch this video. This is kind of interesting.
Rutgers head basketball coach Mike Rice's fiery style has been on public display before. Known for his coaching intensity, Rice was suspended by Rutgers for 3 games last December for his behavior at team practices, with few specific reasons cited by school officials at the time as to why. This is why. This is just some of the video that led to Rice's suspension. Outside the Lines has obtained not only the roughly 30-minute video reviewed by Rutgers officials, but also hundreds of hours of additional footage of Rutgers practices from the two seasons prior to this year. There are shots of Rice heaving balls at players, even at their heads, which you can see better here when the tape is slowed down. Have you ever seen a coach do that?
Never. I mean, unbelievable to me that somebody would feel that that technique can be successful.
Eric Murdoch was a first-round draft pick and played 9 seasons in the NBA. He was hired by Rice, whom he'd never met, in June 2010 to be right.
Doesn't that upset him? There are coaches like that out there that think that by pushing people and bullying people, their bosses in the corporate world that way. Does that motivate you? Doesn't motivate me. Now let's look at a different coach, almost the opposite. Recognize this guy? Chris Peterson. It looks strange to have a University of Washington hat on him. He had so much success at Boise State. Let's listen to Pete and see what his style is.
You don't like to do a lot of these types of interviews. You don't like to be in the media. You want people to be focusing on players, on the team. Is that correct?
I think it's all about the players. And I think, you know, the next most important guys are assistant coaches. I get the head coach is, you know, his responsibilities to do a lot of these things, and everybody thinks it's the head coach. But I really think it's the players and our assistant coaches. And that's why I've had so much success along my journey. Is we've got really, really good players that have been great people. And had a crew of coaches around me that are really special. Not only great football coaches, but really, really good people. You know, that's why I do think that. I think it's about those guys. I think I do too many of these things in the big picture.
I believe you said that the team chemistry outweighs talent. A lot of coaches don't say that.
Well, I don't think we're going to win the Derby on the back of the donkey. So we got to have some guys. We've got to have some players. But I think everybody has talent. I really do. I mean, there's always good players, and certainly in the league that we play in, everybody's got good players. So what's the next step here? And to me, and even some of the teams that I've been involved with, I mean, we've had a lot of talent, and maybe not what we thought we were going to do, and been on teams where the talent was, you know, okay, and then all of a sudden we clicked, and we really enjoyed each other, and it just all came together. And we really, really, you know, supported each other. Well, that's that chemistry thing. And I know that that's as important as anything that we do is the chemistry.
What's an OKG?
An OKG. Love it. That's our kind of guy. And that's especially when we try to recruit here in Washington. And really, it means it's a really good kid. I mean, you walk into the school and everybody goes, oh, that's a great kid. Oh, I like that guy. But he's also a really good football player. He's got all the intangibles, and that's really the hard thing to figure out in this recruiting process. It's competitive, it's driven, it's tough, you know, really wants to be coached, wants to be great, you know, he's reliable, he's accountable, all those kind of hard words to put your finger on. That's what we're trying to find out, and that's what an OKG is to us.
So which kind of coach would you rather play for? Positive, supportive, upbeat. The other tries to bully you into doing what he wants you to do. Maybe even a better question. Which coach would you want your son or daughter to play for? Yeah, me too. I'd have a tough time with my daughter playing for a coach like that. Absolutely. I really believe in the power of positivity. That positive leaders create strong and positive work environments. Players and staff want to work hard, like we talked about a couple minutes ago, and this builds extraordinary teams and organizations. Positivity. It's a different world. People are motivated by positivity. Positive leadership is hard work, though. It really is. True positive leadership. You can't come to work in a bad mood. And if you are in a bad mood, you better change it. That's difficult sometimes. But it's important. You can't come to work in a bad mood. No knee-jerk reactions. You have to think things through and understand what's going to motivate your people. Now, you need to be honest with them. If they're messing up with something, you need to pull them aside. But you can't just react. No belittling or bullying your people. I don't think that would ever happen in this organization. You guys are so positive. It was really refreshing as Phil gave me the tour throughout the facility and meeting so many of you. Upbeat, positive, a lot of smiles. But some organizations do belittle and do bully. You need to be positive and you need to be deliberate about your actions. What do you want to accomplish? Now, we're going to talk about six different topics tonight. The first one is we're going to talk about positive psychology, an introduction to positivity. Then we will move on to defining leadership. Then what is positive leadership? Moving into why should we care about positive leadership, or what are the benefits associated with positive leadership? Then five strategies you can use as a leader to help build a positive and extraordinary organization. And then, what's the first step you should take? What's the first thing you should do? So, an introduction to positivity. To understand positivity, we first must understand positive psychology and then leadership. Positive psychology was born out of the American Psychological Association Convention in 1998. Martin Seligman was the president of that convention, of the APA that year. He's the author of Learned Optimism. And in his keynote presidential address, he said, "We focus too much of our time on mental illness, bringing people from below up to the norm. But we don't concentrate on taking people from the norm and helping them to flourish." And so it was in 1998 that he coined positive psychology. Positive psychology basically is a science that understands and builds upon the most positive qualities of an individual. It has three core concerns: positive emotions, positive traits, and positive organizations or institutions. Positive emotions is no less than just the state of being a person is in when they're positive. And positive emotions could be love, joy, inspiration, hope. Leaders provide hope. Hope for a better day. We don't always achieve our goals. Sometimes we stub our toes. And you as a leader, as a coach, need to pick your players up. Need to pick up your staff and help them to find hope for the future. Positive emotions. Positive traits, on the other hand, numerous different traits. It might be something as simple as hard work. This person works hard. Or it could be compassion or integrity. Doing the right thing. What are the positive traits of your players, of your staff, of your students? strengths and virtues. And then positive institutions or positive organizations, they focus on creating a positive work life, which increases positive performance. It's that simple. The goal of the positive leader is to create a positive work life, enhance both the positive emotions and positive traits of the people, so we have positive institutions and a positive mindset. And that's what the positive leader does, is creates a positive mindset, has a positive mindset, creates a positive mindset. Did you know that negativity is more powerful than positivity? There is so much negativity in this world, isn't there? Turn on CNN. Turn on any news station. It's just littered with negativity. And negativity is more powerful than positivity. In fact, researchers have shown that positivity, it takes about 2.7 to 3 positive interactions just to balance out a negative interaction. So if there's that much negativity, if we are getting bombarded with negativity, we need to have at least 3 positives for every negative just to break even. To live in a neutral state. Do you want to live in a neutral state? So really, you've got to get to about 4, maybe 5 positive interactions for every negative. Now, we can't get away from every negative. Little Johnny does something, a skill incorrectly. You've got to correct that. Now, you can use as positive of words as you can, but you still have to correct it, or he's going to build that skill in a negative fashion. So how do you overcome that negativity in how you talk? In how you sandwich that criticism. Negativity, the Brogdon Bill theory, shows that negativity narrows our line of thinking, narrows our way of thinking, makes us less creative as people, and hurts our decision-making abilities. We become very limited. You get pushing the corner and you see very limited options. Positivity, on the other hand, broadens. You see more possibilities. It's good stuff. Yeah, I can do it. The power of positive thinking is powerful. Let me share a couple of stories with you. When I was the coach at, I was basketball coach at Warburg College in Iowa. I had just gotten hired that year. I had been the head basketball coach at Eastern Oregon University and turned around a real tough culture, a real culture of losing, if you will. And we had the best season in 23 years in my third year. So I get hired at Warburg College, one of the top 25 Division III school in Iowa. And I get hired late, and so I get there in August. There's not going to be any recruiting to do. The team was a pretty average team. The expectations for us were pretty average, not minimal, not great, but pretty average. And we started out the season 5-0. People in the community were shocked. They were really surprised. And then we take our first road trip to Western Iowa. We played a scholarship school there. We were not scholarship. And it's going to be a great game. And it was a great game. Went back and forth, back and forth. And in the end, they hit a shot with about 2 seconds to go to tie it up. We called a quick timeout. Team came over. And we had practiced a last second play. All the time in practice. Now, this was November, early December. And so I'm still trying to get to know them. They're still trying to get to know me. And everybody knew what play we're going to run. We didn't want to throw the ball too long because if it went out of bounds on the other end, it would be our opponent's ball underneath their basket. So what we wanted to do is set a screen for the point guard who would loop around towards our basket. The ball would be thrown over his shoulder. He would catch it about half court, maybe about 50 feet out, square his shoulders, focus on the rim, and take a great calculated shot. Will it go in? Chances are not. That's a long shot. But you do your best. You believe that it might go in. So we have two point guards. One's a sophomore who's just a real tough-minded, positive kid, and one who's a senior with a lot of experience. And the sophomore comes up to me as the team's coming into the huddle. He was sitting on the bench because the senior was in. And he looks me in the eye and says, "Coach, I'll make that shot. Play me, coach. I'll make that shot." Talk to our assistants. We decided to go with the kid with the more experience. Senior. So he makes a great cut off the pick. The pass is delivered just perfect. Instead of squaring his shoulders and taking a good calculated shot, he just slings the ball. Doesn't even hit the backboard. I'm going, "Are you kidding me? What are you doing?" I said to myself. You can see, the game goes into overtime. You can see the emotion on our players just deflate. Their body language. It's like, "What are you doing?" Needless to say, we lost the game. After the game, after the emotions settled down a little bit, I pulled Jason to the side and I said, "How can you even square your shoulders and take a really good look at the basket? We could have won the game." He looks at me and goes, "Coach, I wasn't going to make that shot anyway." "Are you kidding me? You think you're not going to make it? You're not going to make it." Two years earlier, Duke was playing Kentucky in the 1992 East Regional Final. Christian Layton, here on the picture, hits two free throws with 7 seconds left. Kentucky inbounds the ball quickly down one, gets it to their off guard, who comes into the lane, tosses up a little one-handed floating shot from about 12 feet out, it goes in. Kentucky up one, 1.2 seconds to go. Duke calls timeout. They come over to the huddle, and Mike Krzyzewski sits down and looks him in the eye and says, "Guys, we're going to win this game." And they all said, "Yeah, we are. We have 1.2 seconds to get the ball in the basket." Coach K looks at Grant Hill and says, "Grant, you're going to take the ball out of bounds. I need you to take a step this way to get the defender leaning and come back to your right, since you're right-handed, and throw it to the free throw line. You're going to throw it to Christian Layton. Grant, can you make that pass?" "Coach, I can make that pass." Of course they practice this a ton of times. "Christian, you're going to start down on the baseline and flash up to the, cut up to the key, free throw line, and catch the ball cleanly. Can you catch the ball?" Christian says, "Yeah, coach, I can catch the ball." "Then I want you to pivot on your left foot, square up to the basket, focus, and knock it down. Can you do that, coach?" "I'll make the shot." Pass is made perfect. He pivots, squares, knocks it down. They win. Duke goes on to win the national title. Positive thinking. If you think you can, you're more likely that it'll happen. Negative thinking versus positive thinking. Absolutely. You have a choice. Positivity is a choice. Researchers have come up with what is called the 50-10-40 rule. that 50% of our disposition in life, who we are, is genetics. You know what? You're born that way. It's the way it is. 10% of our disposition, 10% of our disposition is based on life events. Some people have a tough time in life. That's part of your disposition. So that leaves 40%. That's your choice. 40% of your disposition, of your personality, is based upon how you think. And if you think positive, good things will come. Because remember, positive thinkers, less stress, less illness, happier life. It's true. But don't you get those little thoughts in the back of your head? Well, you can't do that. God, this stinks. You've got to argue those thoughts. You've got to convince yourself that those little thoughts, that little devil on your shoulder is wrong. And that, yes, I can do it. And I'm going to go out and prove that I can do it. 40%. We have a choice. Positive leadership is applying positivity to leadership. That's all it is. And positivity is what? Emotions, traits, and organization. Positive organization. So now let's define leadership. I like to think of leadership as along a continuum based upon the level of control. At one level, so let's talk about what leadership is first. Leadership is a process where an individual influences a group of people towards a common goal. There's a lot of different definitions of leadership out there, but this is one that Peter Northouse, who writes a book entitled Leadership, and we use in our sports leadership class, this is his definition. I like it. I think it's true. Where a person, it's a process where an individual influences a group of people towards a common goal. By that? Along that continuum of control versus hands off, at one end, we have five leadership styles we'll talk about real quickly. At one end is authoritarian, where the leader is involved in every decision and is very controlling. At the other end of the spectrum is laissez-faire. Hands off. You decide how you're going to proceed. Now, looking at those two extremes, you can say, well, this is better than that, or that's better than this. But doesn't it depend on the situation? For example, if you're a leader in a real dangerous, say, a log mill, and you hire somebody who doesn't have the experience, you better make sure the task is being done and done correctly and in a safe manner. There's probably going to be more supervision and hovering. That control is probably going to be more in that. Whereas if you have, if you're a chairperson of a medical school, are you going to tell a brain surgeon, this is how I want you to do it, and I'm going to hover over you while you're doing the surgery? No. Hands off. Let them do their job. They know what they're doing. Two extremes. In the middle, we have democratic. Some would call that participative, where everybody has a say in what's going to be decided. Then there's bureaucratic. That's, he's supposed to be up there. Sorry about that. And bureaucratic is where you might want to look at an institution of higher learning. The leadership decisions are based upon rules, regulations. I remember when I was in college, you'd get into the wrong line at registration. Long, long line. You get to the front, they go, you know what, you're in the wrong line. Sorry, you need to go to the back of that one. It's not like, sorry about that. You know, let's get you all fixed up here. No. It's rules and regulations. And then the fifth one is people-oriented, where the leader is really concerned about the person. Servant leadership would fit into that category. Where the leader serves his or her people. Serves his or her players, students. People-oriented. What type of leader are you? Where do you fall along that continuum? We asked that question on that handout. At some point, reflect upon that continuum. And write down what type of leader you are. And then maybe reflect on what type of leader you'd like to be. Of their skill or the situation involved. Mimi, don't you use a different leadership style?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, if you have someone on one of your horses and they can't ride real well, you're probably going to use a different leadership style than somebody who is a pro. The situation probably dictates somewhat what kind of leader you are. If you're a coach, say a basketball coach, and you like to be very supportive of your people, and like for example, when at halftime of our games, we'd go into the locker room, and I'd stand outside the doorway with the assistant coaches and say, "What do you see out there that we could change?" And so we three of us talk and come up with different thoughts. Then we go into the room and we look at the players and say, what do you see out there that we can change? And then we get all this information and we make adjustments. You hear of halftime adjustments. That's what it is. I, as a coach, would give our players say, but when we are at the end of the game or we have to run a certain play, I'm more of an authoritarian. This is what we're going to do, and this is how we're going to do it. And we had rules and standards. And you don't break those rules or standards. So different leadership style, depending on the situation, the people, their skill level, absolutely. So what is positive leadership? Positive leadership is a new approach to leadership. It's new as of at least 1998, when positive leadership was founded. It's more around 2003 is when you started seeing that term positive leadership come up. It's an outgrowth of positive psychology. It's based on the concept that workers are happier, more productive. They work harder, they're more productive when they work in a positive environment. Does that make sense? Makes sense to me. And that's why I like the concept. That's how I was as a player. That's how I've always been as a worker, that when I'm supported and positive and have a pat on the back, I work harder, probably more productive. People get the wrong thought about positivity and positive leadership. Oh, it's all sunshine and happiness. No, it's not a Pollyannish attitude. It's not an unreasonable or illogical attitude or of optimism. Almost the opposite. Because it is hard work. And it takes a lot of discipline to be a positive leader. High expectations for your players or work staff members. High expectations for your team or the product you produce. High expectation for the customer service or your donors or your fans or your parents. As a coach, as a leader, I don't want parent interference. We have standards here. And I don't want you as a parent interfering with the team. How about that? But we as parents, don't we want to make sure that little Susie and little Johnny have a more than fair shake at being the star of the team? Getting a scholarship to college? Parents just naturally want that input. So you have to figure that out. You have to weigh what your standards are. But positive leaders have high expectations. They approach these expectations with a can-do attitude. They attack problems with a positive mindset. Remember, positivity gives you more options of how you're going to solve the problem. The bottom line is they look to inspire their folks, their players, their students. They look to encourage them, yes, you can do it. And then they support them. As an athletic director, that's what I tried to do with my coaches. I wanted to support you. I wanted to encourage you. If you need something in order to be successful, what do you need? Let's sit down and talk about it, and let's see how we can accomplish it. What do you need? I'm here to support you. Why should we care about positive leadership? What are the benefits? Why should we care? Positivity is linked to an increase in happiness, performance, and success. Absolutely. That happy employees are 31% more productive than unhappy employees, than their unhappy counterparts. They sell 37% more. This is a study within the business world. And they're three times more creative. How important is creativity to your industry? As a skier or snowboarder, how important is creativity? Probably pretty important, I would think. It's pretty important in basketball, I know that. So, my second or third game as a head coach ever at Eastern Oregon, we were down 2 to Lewis Clark State from Lewiston. They were playing down in the Grand. We were down 2 with, I think it was 1 second to go. Problem is, Lewis Clark State had the ball under our basket. Game over, right? Our point guard, kid out of Moses Lake, really positive, creative guy. The ball was taken, we call timeout, and we tell our kids, we're going to defend this, we're going to deny the inbounds pass. Our hope is to get a steal and make the basket, tie it up going to overtime. So Brand is denying right in front of the ball, where he's on the right side of the court, right in front of our bench. The guy with the ball starts running to his right down the baseline. The official trails him. Brand grabs the guy's jersey, who's on offense, and pulls him on top of it and flops down. The official turns and calls a foul on LC State. Brand steps up, left-handed, hits hits bowl, game goes into overtime. LC State coach is going berserk. Do you teach those kind of morals? Probably not. Is that wrong or is that gamesmanship? We won the game in overtime. How about that? We teach that. We discuss this in my sports philosophy class all the time. Is it cheating or is it gamesmanship? I don't know what it was, but Brent was creative, wasn't he? He found a way to win the game. We didn't talk about that in the timeout. No. No, we didn't. I just burned this thing from my mind. I wasn't a very good player. Probably a better coach than a player, but Brent was a great player. Thought outside the box. Found a way to win the game. We got more creative. In the research study in search of excellence, they looked at the best corporations within the country. What separated them from the rest of the corporations, the rest of the companies? Why were they so good? They found that positive leadership was linked to the success of these extraordinary organizations. That employees were the people, the leaders, the CEOs of these corporations said that the people were the root source of their success, of the quality of the product, and the productivity of the organization. The employees are the root source. And the managers were positive in their interactions and focused on shaping values and reinforcing behaviors. Do you see that as coaches? Values, reinforcing behaviors? Absolutely. And when you do it in a positive manner, you succeed. Can we extrapolate those findings and relate them to the sports world? I think so. I really believe so. There hasn't been a lot of research on that. And I guess I'm the one throughout the country or the world that should be doing this research, and that's my plan. I want to be able to find if we can link positivity to success. Duke's coach looking his players in the eyes and says, we're going to win this game. Versus the kid just throwing the ball and saying, oh, I was going to make it anyway. Positivity. Anecdotal in nature, sure. But can we link success to positivity? We'll find out. When we talk about high standards and expectations, keep in mind the age level, the developmental level of your players. What's good for a 16 or 17-year-old, a 9-year-old might not be able to do. You can't have the same expectations skill-wise for great skill differences or age differences. When leaders create a positive work environment or team environment, the people work harder, the employees and the staff and the players, they work harder, they perform better, and they work as a team. They like coming to work. They like what they're doing. So that brings us to the nuts and bolts of the presentation. How do we become positive leaders? Five strategies. Research says five strategies. The first is we create a positive organizational culture. The second is pursue a positive purpose. The third is cultivate a positive climate. The fourth is to build positive relationships and then engage in positive communication. Let's take each of those five separately. When we talk about a positive organizational culture, an organizational culture deals with a system of shared artifacts, core values, and assumptions of the way you do things in your organization, how people are governed. Artifacts are what you can see, what you can hear and what you can feel. This is a research study that was specifically about sports. They looked at four authors looked at 10 successful sports organizations, and they gleaned this information, artifacts, core values, and assumptions. Artifacts I relate to who I am, and you might not be able to relate to this or not, but I went to Washington State University. Cool logo. When you see that logo as a Cougar, you go, yeah, right on. That's how you feel. You see it, you feel it. Football, kind of go, wow, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. This is our Cougar football team. So over Christmas break, I'm up in Spokane. Will is from Spokane. And we're talking about Birdies, a little sports bar up by where he went to high school and where my in-laws live. And I went and watched the Cougar football game. Cougs won. The Cougars won a bowl game. First time since like 93. The bar erupts, starts singing the Cougar fight song. Fight, fight, fight for Washington. How you feel? What you see? What you hear? Tradition. Culture. Who you are. The second core values are the norms and operating principles of that organization. Your organization has seven different core values. I like that you have them written down. I like that your culture understands the values. That's a good thing. Not all organizations have this listed and have people buying into it. Norms for how you're going to operate. We're going to operate with character, and we're going to have teamwork. There's that creativity, positivity, three times more creative. And then assumptions, the subconscious guidelines to how you operate or how the members follow the leadership, how they follow leadership. It tells them what to pay attention to, what things mean, and how you're going to react to what's going on. Positive Coaching Alliance talks about culture is the way we do things around here. That's culture, isn't it? So the first strategy you have as a leader, we have as leaders, is to build a positive culture. Implement a positive culture. Coach Peterson refers to his players as, remember that art, that video? Our kind of kids. He's really into that. That we're not going to have bad apples on our team. I was always told as a coach that, you know, what do you say? You can't win the Derby by riding the back of donkeys. Yeah. What he's saying is you've got to have players. Players win games. Talent wins. But so does character and chemistry. If you have one bad apple, you might be able to mold and reinforce their behavior into success. You have two bad apples, they're going to come together. And all of a sudden, you have three, four, five bad apples, and you know what? The organization's going south in a hurry. Our kind of kids. More specifically, there are five elements that help shape the culture of an organization. The first is core ideology. In the research study built to last, Collins and Porras found that the best companies in the world had a strong core ideology. And they defined what a core ideology was the combination of core values, which we know you have seven of, and core purpose. Why are you doing what you're doing? The best companies have a strong core ideology. They also have a vision, how we're going to succeed. I'm really impressed with Rob's vision. And you guys are buying into how he sees the future of this organization. I had a chance to read a couple articles and then talk to Rob today. I'm impressed. I really am. And the vision of where we're going in the future and how we're going to get there. The strongest corporations, the best companies, all have a very clear and strong vision. People, you can't win, you can't be successful as an organization or a team without having the right people, can you? Jim Collins talked about getting the right people on the bus, getting the wrong people off the bus, and then getting them in the right positions. That's what the best corporations did. Now, I'll caution you on this. You have to have the right people, don't you? No question about it. Getting the wrong people off, they talk about, and I can relate to my athletic director position where my supervisor was just so negative and awful. You don't just fire people. You train them. You develop them. And if it's not a good fit, if they don't fit into your value system, then you make a change. But you don't willy-nilly start letting people go. Every time you bring in a senior leader to your organization, you're really starting over. So you have to have the right people. Coach Pete has the right people. You have to have high standards. A BHAG. Anybody know what a BHAG is? Anybody hear that term before? Yeah.
Big, hairy, audacious goals.
Big, hairy, audacious goals. Thank you. Absolutely. A BHAG is a big, hairy, audacious goal. Ted Leland is the athletic director at University of Pacific. He was the athletic director at Stanford in the early to mid-90s when Jim Collins put out this research that called for this. As Ted Leland was hired, he comes into the coaches meeting, his first coaches meeting, with the Stanford head coaches. And he said, folks, we are going to be the most excellent, outstanding. At that time, Stanford was thought of as the country club. They were successful in some sports like tennis and golf. But within 3 or 4 years, they won the Pac-12 in football. They won the Pac-12 in basketball. They went on to win the Sears Cup. That was the cup for having the most successful overall athletic department in the country. They won that something like 10 or 12 years in a row. Why? They had high expectations. Here are our expectations. Here are our standards. If you want to buy into it, this is going to be a fun ride. But if you don't want to buy into it, you might want to go somewhere else. Coach Pete talks about standards. He said, we don't have a bunch of rules. You don't have to jump around a bunch of rules. We have standards. And if you can't meet those standards, you might want to go somewhere else. So if you ever see a kid kicked off Coach Pete's team, he didn't live up to the standards. Maybe they got sideways with the law or sideways with their professor or what have you, didn't live up to the standards. And then finally, inspire and motivate. Now, the authors where I took this from, the authors on the sports culture, they talked about reward and punishment. And maybe that's what it is. But as I was talking to a friend of mine who's really into this also, he said, I like calling it discipline instead of punishment. And maybe you want to call it correction. You can't build the wrong, I mean, if as a basketball player, you want to keep your head up while you're dribbling. If you have your head down, you're going to learn how to dribble with your head down. Don't you, as a coach, say, hey, keep your head up? Don't you correct that? The discipline is keeping your head up while you dribble. And if you can't without it getting stolen, you better practice. But the research shows that the top coaches inspire and correct, inspire, discipline, punish, whatever. They shape behaviors. Four steps to strengthening or changing the culture. Define and communicate your core values. What are the values of your organization? Define those and communicate them. Next, utilize teaching tools. Teaching tools could be such as role modeling, highly important. You do what your coach does. If your coach steals the newspaper from the breakfast place, he doesn't think much of it, he just takes it. That happened when I was an assistant coach, or my head coach would take the morning newspaper. And I looked down and said, you can't do that. There are people coming in here to eat breakfast who want to read the newspaper. So he stopped taking the newspaper. I was like a 25-year-old assistant to this 40-year-old, 50-year-old. Yeah, so anyway, roll on. Your players are going to learn to do what's right and wrong based upon what they see from you. If you lie and cheat, they're going to lie and cheat. But if you hold yourself up to a certain standard, they will too. Assignments. The researchers found that in changing the culture and utilizing teaching tools, lectures, personal development, bringing speakers in that share the same message, journaling, personal meetings, team meetings, various teaching tools, and the use of technology. Using computers to analyze performance and correcting performance. And then the third one, after we are using teaching techniques and tools, we recruit people who understand the new culture. Coach B, our kind of kids. He's not going to bring in a thug to be with the other great kids. You work too hard to fill your team with good people. Surround them with people who understand your culture. Communicate that culture to your recruits, your staff members. You hire a new position. Understand what your culture is and let the people who are interviewing understand that and see if they fit into that. And then finally, reward and discipline or correct behaviors of your staff members. If they're not doing things right, correct it. If they're doing things correctly, good job. Keep it up. Four steps to changing culture. The next is positive purpose. The second strategy is to create a positive purpose. People are intrinsically motivated and they work hard and care more when they follow their passion and their calling in life. I really believe that to be true. When Phil gave me a tour of the facilities today, I met Matt, the academic advisor. I could tell by the sparkle in his eye when he talked about the kids, helping the kids to succeed in their goals academically. You could see it was more than a job. You could see that that was probably a passion or a calling that he has. And when you have a passion and a calling, you work harder and you perform better. In sports, it's not just wins and losses, is it? Can't be. You can't just focus on wins and losses. Coach Peterson was quoted in one of the research articles. Without being too corny, I think we need to coach to a bit of a higher calling. There's more to it than just winning. I hope so. I hope we're teaching values. It's consistent with the research that the best companies existed for, quote, a purpose higher than just making money. The best and most successful corporations in the research built to last, it was more than just making money. They had standards, though. So why does your organization exist? What is your why? That best-selling author, Simon Sinek, wrote a book called Why. Or What's Your Why, or something like that. And he goes into, why do you do what you do? Why do you coach? Is it about the wins? Or is it something greater than that? Jim Soper was the football coach at UC Davis. He was the coach for Chris Peterson. Chris was a quarterback there at Davis. Soker is a big believer in teaching values and more than wins and losses. He's been a big spokesperson on that. In his 19 years as a head coach, he won 18 conference championships, all based on the concept of having good kids, teaching values, doing the right thing. The wins will take care of themselves. If you do the right thing, the wins will occur. So I ask you, why do you coach? Why do you coach? You might want to ask yourself that. Before you go to bed tonight, ask yourself, yeah, why do I coach? And if you have a tough time answering that, you might want to look in the mirror and really think deeply on it, because I think it's so vitally important that you understand why you do what you do. Why do I do this? Most of the professors at Idaho State have had 2 weeks off. I've spent it preparing for this. Why? Because I believe, first slide, I believe so much in the power of positivity and the power of positive organizations. I believe that. And I think the message needs to get out. That's why I do what I do. With a positive purpose, once you've identified your greater purpose or what you do, why you do it, communicate it. Let your kids know what this is all about. Let them know that you care about it. The third is a positive organizational climate. Third strategy. So we have first had the positive culture, then we had the positive purpose, now positive climate. It's the perception your employees or team members have of the environment of the organization, the team environment. Is it a positive environment or is it a negative environment? You're somewhere in between. How do they feel when they come to work in the office? It's based on, it's an outgrowth of attitudes, behaviors, and emotions. Positive organizational climates make people feel appreciated. They are more, we've heard this, how many slides now? They work hard, and productivity increases. That's what a positive climate does. Negative climates create dysfunction. People can't wait to get out of practice. They can't wait to check out at the end of their shift and go home. That's what a negative climate does. A negative climate leads to unhappy employees, lack of motivation, decreased confidence, lack of job security, and dysfunction. It does. Research has shown that. When I think of positive leaders, positive climate, I think of Pete Carroll of the Seahawks, Seattle Seahawks in the NFL. He believes in creating a positive climate, that it is one of the most important things you do as a leader. And he talks about infusing energy. So your people are psyched up, they're ready to go, they build that energy. The goal for a leader is to foster a positive work environment for your team or your organization that is uplifting and supportive. The fourth is positive relationships. Now, this is interesting. We talked about negative interactions are more powerful than positive interactions. 2-1, somewhere in that area, you're in a neutral state. 3-1 is about where a positive state begins. However, 15-1, 13-1, 15-1, different research articles show up differently, is too much. It's that Pollyannish where everything's sunshine and happiness. And the bottom line is your employees can't trust what you say, because everything you say is positive. You gotta be honest. You gotta be sincere. The research shows that in building a positive relationship, you need to build what they call a high-quality relationship. HQR. High-quality relationship is what they call it. And it's more than just having a positive relationship. It was great meeting all of you as you came in today. And I would consider that we have a positive relationship. But how deep is it at this level? Not very deep, because we just met. But if we work together, if you were my employer, or you, if I was your employee, or you were my employee, or co-worker, we would want to build high-quality relationship. Much deeper. Get to know the people you work with. Get to know your players. Where are they from? What do they like to do? What are their strengths? What are their weaknesses? What are their pet peeves? What's their wife or husband's name? Or girlfriend or boyfriend? Get to know them deep. What's their favorite color? How old are they? If you could get them a birthday present or Christmas present that would just be so awesome, not a new car, but something that was very meaningful, what would it be? Positive relationships is more than just being friendly. It's being deep. And you as a leader can do that. You can build high-quality relationships. They talk about 360 degrees. So, the people above you build high-quality relationships, your co-workers to the side, your employees below you, or players. Followers want from their leaders the truth. They want to be able to trust them. So, I've been in a lot of organizations, higher ed, where some of the CEOs try to put spin on things. Just be honest. Be transparent. If you can't do something, just say, hey, I can't do it. But maybe together we can be creative in figuring out a way how we can do it. Integrity. They also want compassion, they want hope, and they want stability. That's not too much to ask, but that's hard work, isn't it? As a leader, as a positive leader, creating these four things, you can't come to work in a bad mood. You gotta really care about the person. If they start spilling their guts to you, you can't say, okay, all right, yeah, yeah, whatever, yeah, yeah. No, care, be compassionate. Support them. Focus on energizing and uplifting your people. And create the flywheel effect. What's the flywheel effect? It's a teamwork. Flywheel is about teamwork. Let's say that in your organization there's this giant flywheel. Rob comes in and says, we need to push it this way. And it's heavy. It's just heavy. And he's just struggling to push this flywheel. And Phil says, hey, let me help you, Rob. And they both are pushing the same way. And then Mimi says, hey, I'll help you. And Jody jumps on board. And Matt jumps on board. And it starts going. And it starts going by itself. And it's bam, building steam, picking up steam. And then one of your employees comes and says, you know what? You guys are, this organization is going the wrong direction. We need to go this direction. And they start pushing against you. And you're pushing this way, they're pushing that way. And what's the flywheel do? What's the teamwork do? It stalls, doesn't it? Yeah. The flywheel effect. Teamwork. Have that vision, all push the same way, building on relationships, positive relationships, all pushing the same direction. And then finally, positive communication. Fifth strategy you can use as a leader. And as a positive leader, you'll want to communicate positively. And that's a skill you can develop. People can develop positive communication. You need to understand what to say and what not to say. For example, negative communication, two or three times more difficult. You just see some people that are just negative in what they say. Look up. Turn it around. Instead of saying, I hope that team loses, say, you know what, I hope this team wins. I don't know, just kind of a little pet peeve of mine. Be positive in your communication. Positive communications are supportive, affirmative in nature. They are genuine, they're authentic, they're sincere. I think we said supportive. Supportive. What can I do to make your job easier? What can I do to help you perform better? Negative communication. Research has shown that criticism, contempt, defensiveness, stonewalling, that creates negativity. But remember, not all communication can always be positive. No, it can't. There has to be correction. It doesn't have to be criticism. You don't criticize a person, you correct the behavior. Sandwich the criticism. Kyle, though Johnny made a great effort, but I want you to keep your head up while you're dribbling. Do it this way, you'll find success. John Wood, the great basketball coach, really believed in this. You make the slightest error, he would stop practice and correct you. Maybe someone's not bending their knees on their shot. whoa, hold up. I like your effort, but I want you to bend your knees as you're shooting. Coach, I was bending my knees. No, you went like this. I need you to bend your knees as you come up. Concentrate. You'll do a great job. Let's go. Let's try it again. Positive, correct, positive. Target of five. The positive coaching alliance suggests that you target a 5-to-1 positive to negative. Leadership. Workers are happier, they work harder, they're more productive in a positive environment. First thing, recognize the power of positivity. And then from there, understand that people do work harder and they do perform better when they're supported in a positive nature. And then implement the 5 strategies. Culture, implement the 5 elements of building a positive culture. Purpose, answer the question, why do I coach? Or why am I in this organization? Why do I do what I do? Climate, create a positive team environment. The atmosphere. Relationship, build high quality relationships. Deep, get to know them. Care about them. And then communicate with the 5 formation. That's it. Thank you. I'm on the board of directors of the Idaho Youth Sports Commission. And I think, Phil, that's how you originally got a hold of me.
That's right.
Yeah, and we're trying to spread positive coaching throughout the state of Iowa. So anyway, I wanted to, if you have thoughts on the Idaho Youth Sports Commission, that's our website. And then that's me below that, and my website, positiveleader.com.